Okay, so what we're going to do now, as topological vector spaces are too weak to have a sort of a meaningful differentiation, at least not when it comes to curves, or we get this very pathological behavior, we need to strengthen a little bit what we require of the topological vector spaces. And so I have to introduce these so-called locally convex spaces. And for this, we find a definition of a so-called semi-norm. So a semi-norm is, you basically take the same things you know from the definition of a norm. So you want homogeneity, so you can take out scalars using the absolute value of the scalar, and it should be sub-additive. However, what is missing, or why this is a weakening of the norm property, we don't have that the semi-norm is zero if and only if we are inserting the zero element from the vector space. So this is weaker than the usual notion of norm, and gives us a little bit more of wiggle space to define topologies using these semi-norms. And this comes now on the next slide. So here we call a topological vector space locally convex space, or just locally convex, if there is a family of continuous semi-norms for some index set, such that the vector topology we have there is the initial topology with respect to the family of canonical projections. So what's happening here is, what are these canonical projections? So you basically, whenever I have a semi-norm, so there's potentially a lot of elements which are sent to zero. So something which you could call the kernel of the semi-norm. And when you quotient that out, you quotient out from E the subspace of all elements which get sent to zero by PI. On one hand, you have to check that this kernel really is a subvector space of E, but that can be done. So this quotient here, the E mod, the P inverse of zero, so this is then again a vector space, and what you can prove is, since you've quotiented out the kernel of PI, so the semi-norm PI then induces a norm on this quotient. So E mod PI inverse of zero, this becomes a normed space with respect to the norm induced by PI. And so we have this whole family of semi-norms. We get this whole family of canonical projections, and we want that our vector topology is the initial topology with respect to this family of canonical projections. The second thing we ask is that the semi-norms are point separating. So what we want is that if we have an element in our vector space which is sent to zero for all of the semi-norms simultaneously, then the element is zero. What you can prove is the consequence of the semi-norms being point separating is that the topology has a Hausdorff property. And since we want in this lecture that all the topologies are Hausdorff, we have to require this point separation property to get a locally convex space. One short note, in the literature, there are lots of people who also consider locally convex spaces which are not necessarily Hausdorff. So in their notation, this or what we say is a locally convex space would be a Hausdorff locally convex space, but we always want the Hausdorff property here. Okay, and before we go on, I mean, we continue a little bit with this definition, but on the next slide, we should look a little bit closer on what we mean by that T is the initial topology. This might seem a little bit abstract. Yeah, well, I want that my vector topology is some initial topology with respect to these canonical projections. And there's a perhaps easier description of such a locally convex topology, which might be more in line what you know from the setting of norm spaces. Okay. However, just a little bit more lingo. So if we have a topology which satisfies these properties, so it's the initial topology with respect to the quotients, then we say the topology T is generated by the family of semi-norms, or we call this family a generating family. And again, as with topological vector space, we usually suppress the topology and write simply E with the family of semi-norms if we want to emphasize the family of semi-norms, or simply E. Usually, it will either be clear what the semi-norms are, or we don't care too much about what the semi-norms really are. Okay. However, I want to go a little bit into some details, which are explained in Appendix A of the lecture notes, and explain why these spaces are called locally convex spaces. So first of all, let's recall that a subset of a vector space is called convex if for any two points, this convex combination, so tx plus 1 minus t times y, is in U for all t from the interval from 0 to 1. What this basically means is if you have two points, so you have the x and the y here, and so you have your set U lying around this, then what these convex combinations model, they are just all the points which lie on the line connecting x and y. And you say U is convex whenever such a line is lies complete for any two points in the set lie completely inside of the set. Okay, so this is convexity. And what's easy to see from the definition of the semi-norms is that the semi-norm ball in a locally convex space is convex, right? So these semi-norm balls are convex sets. And what you can prove is that's a consequence of the topology being initial with respect to these projections onto the quotients. The semi-norm balls of this kind, they form a basis of the topology. So recall, a basis of the topology means whenever you have an open set and a point inside of this open set, you can find one of these semi-norm balls centered at the point you are given, which lies completely inside of the open set. And so a consequence which we will exploit several times during this lecture is that if you have a locally convex space and you have a point x which lies inside of an open set, so this is a convention I want to use for the open set. So we have this somewhat funny symbol here, which just means the subset U is an open subset of the topological space E. And so whenever you have a point in an open subset, then you can find an open convex neighborhood of your point inside of your given open set. So the U is not necessarily convex, but you can always shrink the U to get a convex neighborhood. And then there are a few nice exercises in point set topology that you can show that you can construct all kinds of convex neighborhoods of points. So you can this shows that you have open convex neighborhoods. You can also have closed convex neighborhoods inside of the U and so forth, right? So there's lots of leeway. So this is one of the good properties we want to exploit for calculus. Actually, this convexity property will be responsible in the end for the validity of the theorem that if you have a curve which has nowhere vanishing derivative, then the curve cannot be constant, or in other terms, we cannot have this pathological behavior of an injective curve such that the derivative vanishes everywhere. Okay, so this is one of the properties we absolutely want. And the second property we will be needing is a classical thing which we prove in a functional analysis course. This is a so-called Hahn-Banach theorem. And what the Hahn-Banach theorem states is that for a locally convex space, the continuous linear functionals separate the points. This means if you have two different points, I mean, x needs to be different from y, then you can find a continuous linear map from your locally convex space with values in the reals such that the functional evaluated in these two points is not equal, right? So basically the functionals separate the points. And we will see later that all of these properties are not satisfied by the example or by this exercise we saw in the last chapter of the LP space for P strictly smaller than one, right? So this is not a locally convex space. And what you can prove is that basically there are no open convex neighborhoods except for the whole LP space inside of this LP space. And the only continuous linear mappings from the LP space when P is smaller than one is the constant zero map, mapping everything to zero. Okay. Right. So this is the Hahn-Banach theorem. Now I want to switch over away from the slides to more traditional style lecture. Right, so now we'll actually take notes. And so let's start with some examples again about normed spaces. Okay, I mean, oh yeah, so I said it. So a normed space E with the norm is a locally convex space since every norm is a semi-norm. And well, I mean, if you look at the canonical projection map, so what you have here, E modulo, and now I need to take the inverse of zero, of up to the semi of the norm of the zero, but this is just the zero space. So we have E here, and this is the identity map. So basically what you get from this is that even if I do this construction with the canonical projections, the norm topology is a locally convex topology. And we, of course, know this because balls of norms are convex, and we know that they form a basis of the topology, right? So in this way, locally convex spaces generalize normed spaces. Okay, now the second example, which we care very much about, is the space of all smooth curves from the interval from 0 to 1 with values in the reals. So space of smooth curves. And so this is a vector space with respect to pointwise operations, right? So I can pointwise add and scalar multiply functions. And now I have to define some semi-norms. So let's define some semi-norms, and it will be an exercise to check that these are semi-norms and they really induce a nice Hausdorff topology. So if I have an F, then I define the N semi-norm to be the supremum over all K smaller or equal than N of the derivative of my curve F in the supernorm, or in other words, so this is, of course, sup over T in 0, 1, and then we take the derivative of this one. Okay, and so here we have a family of semi-norms over indexed over the natural numbers. So we have all these semi-norms, and note that individually these semi-norms are they have the nice property that if the semi-norm maps something to zero, because we are taking the sup here over of the function values of the f. So these semi-norms actually every semi-norm has a kernel which is just the zero map. However, if we take the topology generated by all of these semi-norms, we don't get a normed topology. C infinity from 0, 1 to R with the topology generated by these semi-norms. We get a locally convex space. And the topology is called the compact open C infinity topology. And we will encounter this topology several times during the lecture. However, one thing I want to note, which is also part of the exercise, or the exercises in this chapter, is since there are only countably many semi-norms inducing the topology, one can show that the topology is metrizable. What does this mean? This means it comes from a metric. And you can write down this metric. So this metric DFG is by definition, so you sum up over all the natural numbers, take the semi-norm of F minus G, N, so the nth semi-norm. Obviously, if we just do this, we cannot expect that this series converges. So we have to basically normalize the whole thing. Make it a little bit smaller. Something like this, and still, I mean, who knows? So all of this, all of this might still be too large, but so we can do this the small trick. So now, this converges surely because it's smaller than a geometric series. So if you take this metric, for example, this will induce the same topology, so the compact open C infinity topology, and one can show that the space C infinity, this metric, is complete when a Fréchet space. If you haven't seen Fréchet spaces, this name Fréchet space, so what a Fréchet space is, it's basically a locally convex space which is metrizable and complete. So it's just a shorthand for complete locally convex space whose topology is given by in this way by a metric. Okay. Right, so we care very much about these function spaces. They will be dealt with in chapter 2. However, shall exploit now the Hahn-Banach theorem. Uh, And so basically, I want to introduce a tool which will allow us to see that this pathological behavior we know from topological vector spaces cannot happen. And this is done in the following definition, which we will be using to mimic the proof from the finite dimensional setting as to how we can reconstruct a function from its derivative. So let's say we have a continuous curve into a locally convex space. And let's say we fix two points A and B in the interval. If there exists an element, let's call it V, in our locally convex space, such that I want to evaluate lambda, so a continuous linear map from E with values in the R in X, and this should be the same as the integral from A to B of lambda composed with this curve gamma of t dt. This relation should hold for all lambda in E prime. So E prime is a very usual notation. So what this means, another notation would be capital L from E with values in the reals. Those are, this is the topological dual space of E, or in other words, aka the set of all continuous linear mappings.
Sorry, Bob, just a quick comment.
Yep, sure.
On the left-hand side, you mean lambda of V, right?
Oh, so yes, sorry. Exactly, thanks. Exactly, yeah, so this is lambda of V, exactly. Yeah, so basically, if there is an element such that whenever we evaluate this, or evaluate any continuous linear map in this element, and we get the same as if we had integrated the same mapping applied to the curve. So note, this is a curve from the interval with values in the reals. Right, so this integral we have here, this is a usual, say, Riemann integral, if you want, right? So an element with this property that it satisfies this this relation for all the linear functionals is called a weak integral. Okay, so basically, this gives us a notion of how we can integrate curves in locally convex spaces. I mean, the question is, of course, does this weak integral even exist? Right. So there's, at the moment, we've just made a definition. It's not clear whether any weak integral should exist at all. However, by the Hahn-Banach theorem, if a weak integral exists, it is unique. Right? I mean, still we have no clue whether such a weak integral exists. But at least if it exists, then it's unique. And let's prove a small proposition using these weak integrals. Again, we let's postpone for a moment the question whether such integrals exist. So this is the first part of the fundamental theorem of calculus. And so it says the following. So again, we take a curve with values in a locally convex space. So this should be a C1 curve with values in a locally convex space. Let's assume again that we have two A and B inside I. Then the difference of gamma evaluated in these two endpoints is the weak integral from A to B over the derivative of gamma like this. Okay, and this formula should look very familiar from finite dimensional calculus or just the usual calculus. Let's do a proof of this to see how one works with these weak integrals. So first of all, we choose our continuous linear mapping from E with values in the reals. And we consider the curve of lambda composed with gamma. So this is now a curve from I with values in the reals. And what happens if I take the derivative of this curve? Well, it turns out if you just go to the usual definition with the differential quotient, since the lambda is continuous and linear, you can just take it out. So it becomes lambda of the derivative of gamma. Okay. This is just a formula for the derivative, and we have exploited that the lambda is continuous linear. So the usual fundamental theorem for the reals or the vector space R yields then the following. So if I have lambda of gamma of B minus gamma of A, this is the same as the integral from A to B, or sorry, the same as lambda of the integral of this one. Let's see, prime of S ds. Okay. However, on the other side, I can also write this as lambda of gamma of B minus lambda of gamma of A. Now, we have the usual fundamental theorem. So A from A to B, we have lambda composed with gamma, derivated at S ds. We use our nice little formula for the derivative, A to B, lambda composed with gamma prime S ds. And rewriting this formula, we just see that we have exactly the relation for the weak integral, right? So this works for all continuous linear mappings on the space. And we see that gamma of B minus gamma of A must be the weak integral. Again, this is all there was to prove. So the difference of these two of the two endpoints is the integral over the derivative. Okay, and what we note here, this proposition 116 shows that LP 01 cannot be a locally convex space. Right? Because if it were, then we would always get zero, because the right-hand side, if we integrate over the derivative and the derivative is always zero, then we get zero. So we would have a constant curve and cannot have an injective curve. Okay. Short remark. Well, I said this is the first part of the fundamental theorem of calculus. Also, the second part is true. What do I mean by this? So if gamma from I to E is a continuous curve, and the weak integral eta of t from A to B, you integrate gamma. That's not how I wanted to do it. Let's change the indices here. So from you integrate from A to T over S ds, right? So the eta has its T as a parameter. So if this exists for all T in your interval, then eta, so this curve from I to E is a C1 curve with derivative. So, I mean, the obvious thing should now happen. If we derivate this, then you get back just the curve you started with. And this is true, but we are not going to prove it in this lecture, because you basically need to look a little bit closer at convex sets, and you need some more techniques to estimate these integrals, which is a bit technical, and we're usually not needing the second part of the fundamental theorem, so I'm skipping the proof here. You can find it in the literature, and also the lecture notes reference it. Okay. The question now becomes, of course, when do weak integrals exist? And, again, the answer is quite technical, so we are not going into this. So one can show that weak integrals of continuous curves always exist in the completion E over bar of E. So the reason I won't discuss this here is twofold. On one hand, I don't really want to discuss how you complete a locally convex space. Basically, you have to, so there's a formal procedure, and it's a little bit more complicated than what you know, say, from normed spaces, because in locally convex spaces, it's usually, at least in general, not sufficient to test continuity or completeness using sequences. So you have to be a bit more general than that. You have to take nets, or some literature calls it some Moore-Smith sequences. I don't want to talk about all of these things, because usually for what we are going to do, completeness is irrelevant. But let's cheat a little bit and give a definition, which is still not telling you what's going on, but we will encounter this property several times over the course of these lectures. So a locally convex space E is Mackey complete. If for every smooth curve gamma from the unit interval with values in E, there exists a smooth curve eta, also from the unit interval E, with the property, if you derivate eta, you get gamma. Or in other words, eta of t is the same as the weak integral from a to t of s. So in principle, what this Mackey completeness condition does, it requires the existence of a certain number of weak integrals. And of course, I haven't explained to you how you check that something is Mackey complete. I mean, you still have the problem. If I give you a smooth curve, how would you construct the weak integral? One standard way of doing this is sort of just by writing down Riemann sums. However, it turns out that this Mackey, I mean, this would then basically lead you towards something like sequential completeness. So you have to ask whether all Cauchy sequences or all Cauchy nets converge. However, it turns out that this Mackey completeness condition is a very weak completeness condition. So meaning that whenever you know, for example, that all Cauchy sequences converge in your locally convex space, then you can prove that this automatically implies that it's Mackey complete. So basically, I'm cheating here since I don't want to discuss completeness of locally convex spaces. We more or less will always assume that the spaces we will be working in are Mackey complete. So the weak integrals we need exist. This is quite a reasonable assumption, actually. So there are all of this, the examples we will encounter of the locally convex spaces will be Mackey complete. Okay, right. So last comment, one can prove that if a space is Mackey complete, then the weak integral of all C1 curves exists. So there's a nice little argument which gives you this. So for Mackey completeness, we have only required the existence of integrals for smooth curves, but it turns out that it already exists for C1 curves. Okay, so what we have done so far now, we have defined differentiable and smooth curves with values in a locally convex space. The next task will now be to a calculus for mappings on locally convex space. So far, we have only looked at curves taking values in locally convex spaces, but now we'll use what we have learned about the locally convex spaces and show that there's a well-behaved calculus on locally convex space, or for mappings which are defined on locally convex space and take values in locally convex spaces.